in action app that has been adopted in Drupal. So basically, while working in Drupal, you wouldn't require that much depth of what's in how Symfony works. But it's just good to know what makes the backbone of Drupal work and have a fair idea of how the goal has been made. So I will be presenting the main components of Symfony that has been adopted into Drupal. I work for ValueBound and let's get started. Okay, so basically before till Drupal 7, Drupal was a little bit closed in what it used to invent, it used to do that code by this practices which were formed in Drupal communities. But while designing Drupal 8 has become more open and has started borrowing the best practices of community, overall PHP community, and has taken things like Symfony, Composer, all these things have been adopted into code so that you don't have to learn Spanish to start Drupal. You don't have to learn Drupal language to actually start coding in Drupal. So they have tried to make it more developer friendly so that people are easily, they can easily adopt to Drupal. So that has been the basic idea of adopting a framework into Drupal. So the framework which has been chosen has this Symfony. Okay, let me just give you one more idea before moving to Symfony. So all of us who have been working on Drupal, I think, are familiar on functional programming, how Drupal 7 handled everything. So can anyone tell me how can in my custom module I write a custom page, hello world page in Drupal 7? Okay, and that calls one function. Okay, callback function. So basically, there is a loud item which was written in book underscore menu. Okay, and then there was a function which was called and which returned my mark. But suppose the application grows and the module provides a lot of functionality, maybe email functionality, and you want to alter the subject of that particular whatever output the module provides. So what used to happen is you generally used to have hooks to alter that functionality. So if a module didn't provide an alter hook, you used to just hijack that module and use it the way you wanted to use it. Okay. But in Drupal 8, it would be more easier for us to specifically override one specific method or one specific functionality of that module using classes, which is a standard practice everywhere. So I need not, many people will be familiar with classes, so we will speak about a little bit about it. And in past few years, frameworks have also come in, so which has standardized the way community writes the code and it has adopted many standards from Java community into PHP, and there are many PHP frameworks like Symfony, KPHP, which are very famous, and there are third-party libraries also there, like Oxen and other. And there are other things which have been formed in recent years in general PHP community, and Drupal has become more open to adopt those things into Drupal. So these are some of the components of Symfony and how Drupal has been formed using Drupal Symfony components like class loader, dependency injection, event dispatcher, HTTP foundation, HTTP kernel, routing, serializer, validator, YAML. There are other helper components like page, clock time, Guzzle, many more. So we will look into a few of them. So what I could understand from reading any docs is Symfony was basically adopted over other frameworks because you need not write your application just according to that framework. You are able to adopt components which are more or less independent of how they function. So you don't would have been possible just to adopt one, maybe like HTTP foundation component into Drupal, and they would only need to adopt complete Symfony. So it has helped Drupal to extract whatever component it feels it can borrow from Symfony and still carry some of the legacy which has created and bring out a new framework in which we can write code. Okay. These are the components of Symfony in which routing has been adopted, even dispatcher has been adopted, dependency injection has been adopted, foundation has been adopted, then serializer has been adopted, validator has been adopted, and HTTP kernel. So in Symfony, we have a string of all bundles, but Drupal is providing us by default bundle, and that we don't need to figure out what bundles are for writing Drupal application, but Symfony provides any bundles which function like R modules, which provides different functionality, like for mailing, there is a different component and they can interact. Then there is a main bundle which interact with the other. But in Drupal, what we have modified is that we have kept one main bundle and we can still write modules which will extend our functionality, whatever is required. Okay. So this is, we are just starting the HTTP foundation. So there is a sample thing which comes into our browser. Somebody types in sample.com/foo.html. So grossly speaking, how can we understand what will happen after this? Can anyone? Grossly speaking, what will happen after this?
Yes. Yes.
How do you communicate with server? Okay, so it doesn't matter to my browser whether you are writing your application in PHP or Python or whatever. We have one standard communication tool to speak to the browser. And browser ultimately doesn't understand any language, it knows only HTML. Okay, it doesn't know Python. Depending upon the server, it should finally give us HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That's all the browser understands. Doesn't understand any other language. So basically, when somebody types this in the browser, a request goes from the server, or from the browser to the server, and that page is requested. So this is the request, and what you get in return is called response. Without any language or anything, this is a request and this is the response. Okay. So this is how a simple request looks like. Get this page from the host list in language text/HTML, and in get request we can do these four type of HTTP request: get, post, put, or delete. Okay. This is how it is plain English. So this request can it goes to the server. So PHP has a standard way to understand what kind of request is coming into it. Okay, so it has a low level of abstraction where we have global variable __server_session_file_get, where all the things which are requested are coming to global variables. That's how it functions. So basically what happens is, this is just a low level abstraction. But suppose I want to get the IP of the person who is has given the request. So we could just do simply like, client IP is this, we get it from global variable. But what happens if the request is coming from behind the proxy? It becomes a little tricky. So we have to check from something in the and get the exact IP of the user. Then suppose the proxy is not trusted, so it becomes more complicated. So handling that kind of request is getting difficult in PHP abstraction. So this is something like if we have some trusted proxy, so we get the client IP out of that global variable. But Symfony has provided a more abstract method using classes through which we don't need to deal into this. And so here's an example of Symfony request. So request is created from global variables. Suppose you want to alter something, you can firstly get whatever value, like you want to get foo, you can also just on that point, if you want to change it, you can also change it. So this is how it happens in Symfony. Mostly when we are writing Drupal code, we won't be even dealing with this. Drupal has also made this abstract for us. We won't know about that here. This is being handled by Drupal. But just to know, get an idea why this Symfony has been adopted, and this will make our life easier when we work on bigger applications where we might require sometimes to alter such things. Now coming to response. So basically response is similar to just like the request was an abstract way. There is an HTTP response. We have the HTTP date, server, content type, and the HTML is returned, complete HTML. So the browser understands only HTML with some JSS and CSS and files like images. So how this is used in Symfony is an example has been shown that we are forming an object of response class, and then we can get the values and whatever we want to do, we can do and send the request back to the server. So this is basically the HTTP foundation component of Symfony, which provides us request and response functionality in an abstract way using classes. This has been adopted in Drupal way. Okay. Now coming to routing. So we just saw foo.html. So that is the route for my application. So how did Drupal 7 handle such requests? Anything coming to my browser, we don't have files saved in our main folder. Earlier when we used to do it through GreenViewer, we had all the .html files into one folder and all the pages used to go from there. There was no other. But how does Drupal 7 handle that thing? How is it dynamic?
Yes.
But who are you guys? But where does my first request go?
Bootstrap.
Yeah, it goes to index.php and then it goes to the bootstrap file and everything gets okay. And there we have a function even named at Drupal HTTP request, which was handling that in Drupal 7, the request and the response earlier. Now coming to the route and foo.html, earlier how we used to write such thing was in foo_menu. But it was a little bit confusing in the sense that it used to play my dual role, one of route and one of menu item. These two things were not separated. Menu item can be my primary menu, secondary menu, tertiary menu. But a route is a route. It need not be in the menu. So it was not separated. Now whoever has very good idea about Drupal, they will already know that there are route.variable file is different and the menu files are different, tab files are different. So I will just show you one example of how we write the route. Routes are wrote in YAML language, which is a human friendly way to return an array. That's it. So this actually, this component, when you study in Symfony, is a class and there are more things into it, but in Drupal, you just need to write this route, whatever classes has to be done, how they are loaded through factory and everything is just kept hidden for us. You just have to write a route file and that returns the route. Okay. I think this is pretty easy to work and understand.
Or if you are
separate controllers. So that some people would be already familiar with model view and controller. We won't go to any depth of that, but I used to have a callback function on my in my hook underscore menu. I used to return my values which I used to, I wanted, whether it had be a form or be it a normal page. But in Drupal 8, we have adopted a Symfony. So what we will be doing is we will be writing a method in a class which will return my markup. Okay, so basically you are writing a function, but not as an independent function, but as a part of class. So which will be responsible for returning that markup? It can be of a simple page or controller, simple page controller or form controller. That's a different. So basically this is like a callback function which will return your markup. Okay. This is a sample controller which is kept in src/controller folder, which just returns this markup of hello world. Okay, so we basically writing a public function content. So this was called in my route item. So route item knows which controller needs to be called, and that function will be called, and then my markup will be returned. Okay. So this is the basic application flow till now. A request come for different pages. It goes to my find controller, which stays in index.php. Okay. And then it is handed to Symfony to kernel. We will speak shortly to what is Symfony to kernel. Then the URI element foo.html, which we wrote, will figure out which controller needs to be called. It will call the controller, and then it will call the particular function in that controller, like we have content function right now in that controller, and that response will be returned. Okay, so now we are speaking for one more important component of Symfony, that is event dispatcher. So event dispatcher and HTTP kernel will be a little bit more closely related, so we will speak about them in the So event dispatcher basically just like we used to have actions in Drupal 7, that is on a little higher level, like anything, suppose we are saving a log, we can return the, if we want to send email to few people, we can send the email. So that is the role of event dispatcher. But I will just explain a little later that even the request which is coming will also generate one request event. And suppose few classes want to still alter my get, so we will have some listeners to incoming request that will request the event will be generated, whatever it needs to be done will be done, then it will be passed on to the next. Okay, so event dispatcher is a little more intact, not just like action and rules in Drupal 7. It's a little more abstract of how things are being handled. Also doing some part of hooks also into it, and some part of action into it. So that is how powerful it is. So this is a sample code of Symfony, I think, which is just sending the emails to few people. I'm not speaking more about the code, I'm just giving you an idea about how things are. Okay. So coming to HTTP kernel. So anything between a request to response is being handled by HTTP kernel. Anything between request to response, how my request is ultimately converted into response, is part of my kernel. Okay, it interacts with route, these things, that's a different part, but the basic responsibility of converting my request to response is being handled by kernel. Okay, so this time I quote, so when user asks for resource in the browser sends a request to the server. Symfony gives the developer a request object, the developer converts the request object into response object, server sends back the response to the browser, and the browser displays the response to the user in English. Okay, so in diagrammatic way, a request comes and it is handed to kernel. Kernel finds out the controller. So finding of controller is part of kernel. Which controller needs to be called, how that route will be converted, part of kernel. Then if my controller will return the HTML, fine enough. But if suppose we want to have some TPL.php file, which needs to make the markup more powerful, then it will call the view part of it. Okay, the kernel view. So here now enumerate we have adopted with, so that views will be written into kernel, but that will be handled by kernel view, and that response will again be written, and then the kernel will turn in. Okay.
And then the cache.
Yes? Cache. So I will just explain you a little bit. And I have not read much about it, that's what I will speak about my. So here, there is a request coming, and I told you that request event is generated, and whatever classes or listeners, route is basically a listener to request event. Route is basically a listener to request event. So it will find the controller. So if suppose I already have the response without even interacting with controller route, I just have the response. Here I feel where the cache can come in. It will directly, if there is a response, the response will be directly sent back to the browser. No kernel will come into picture. Okay, so that's what I feel. Here the cache should come in. The request will finally be given, the response will be given back to the browser. Okay. Suppose there is no response. Okay, so what will happen is it will look for the controller, then the controller event will be fired, then the arguments will be found, find out what arguments, how they have to be given to the controller, and then finally the controller will be called. That's the workflow of calling the controller. So basically, if there is no response, the controller will be found out, and then finally the controller will be called with specific arguments, what needs to be passed to the controller, in whatever form it will be called. So if suppose I want to alter some function, want to alter the arguments coming into it, maybe we have a hook for that. Right now, the controller function, then a controller event will be fired. So we will have some listeners who would be listening to controller event, and then it can do whatever changes to argument it wants to do, and then give it to the controller. Finally, this is how the controller is called. Okay, the complete thing, if a view is also required, a view will also be. The view event will also be called. If the view event is not required in a simple markup, then it won't be called. And if there is a requirement for some request, suppose my something is calling some other thing, so it will again initiate that process, and all other things will be added into the final response, and the response will be given back. If there is any errors in between, then the exception event will be fired. There are any event that is not a valid response. Okay, so that will be given to exception, and then we can, the exception event will again have listeners, whatever you want to do with the exception, you how we want to present it manually to the browser will be given. So this is an example of it. This is the code of index.php where the kernel thing is called, and we don't need to go into any details, but this is written in the index.php of Drupal. How this kernel is being handled. You won't actually go to this stuff. You know, we never require to change index.php, but just to have an idea that this is being handled. the tool. So now coming to dependency injection. This is also a very wide topic. I think I won't be able to give too much justice to this particular topic, but I will try to present, give a very small idea. I have found many resources in the end. You can finally look into it and see whatever topic you would like to study in more detail, you can study in more detail. So dependency injection is like, suppose I am writing a notifier module. Contributing notifier module. Okay. And suppose I hard code it like this. That is my constructor. I create the mailer object from where an instance of the mailer class. Okay. Now what will happen is I don't know which mailer the other person is using. You might be using any mailer class. So this won't be able to do justice to my code, especially when I am doing the contributed code. And also in general practices, we might change our mailer class while we are moving on to the project. So we must not make ourselves handicapped with the way everything is hard coded into one specific functionality. We could keep these things a little bit separate, how these things are handled. So what is done is, this notifier is given a object of any class which has the mail interface. Okay, it need not be specific class. Any class which has mail interface will be able to create that object, and then the message will be sent. Okay, so this two lines of code is basically in my custom module. Last two lines are like my custom module, and these are part of my contributed module. So this custom module is basically initiating that whichever, like my special mailer class object, and then it passing to the constructor. So earlier what we were doing is we were initiating it in our constructor. Now what we are doing is we are creating the object out elsewhere and then passing it to the constructor, so it can handle whatever way it wants to handle. Okay. So this is a very wide topic. Anyone would like to know, there is a very good video I have given at the resources. You can have a look into it. Thank you. So coming to composer. So how we used to handle third party libraries in or PHP in Google 7, we used to just download it and put it in the library folder. That's how we used to do it in Drupal 7. But in recent years, just like Power has been found for JavaScript, similarly, the tool called Composer is there where all third party libraries, even Symfony, they decide. So it's easier for us to get the exact version of our library from one repository, and there is one standard API through which we can just download whichever version we want of that particular library from one repository. All third party libraries which are public are kept in Composer for PHP. There are other libraries, for JavaScript libraries, something for Java and for other things in the other. Okay. So this is a small example of how a composer.json file can reside my Hello World module. And if suppose I want MailChimp of version 2.0.6, so this is a very simple example. You can include that into my module. Okay. Now coming to namespace and autoloading. So basically, if we wanted to include any file in Drupal 7, we need to write include or require underscore R. We are familiar with these two terms. All of us are familiar, whatever language you write, we are familiar with these two terms. Require, require and include. So in Drupal 8 and in general Symfony, what it is done is that there is a tool through which we can auto-load those classes without writing these two lines of require and include. It knows where exactly is my particular class, because you are writing everything now in classes, it will become more difficult if you want to write include and loop and require again and again. It will become more difficult. Earlier it was not, because we had many require and include, but it will become very difficult for us to find out the exact part of that class and then include that. So then this happens with very easily through autoloaders, which PSR4 we are using. So basically, the folder structure, whether you should reside in SRC slash controller, you should reside in SRC slash Drupal slash controller, or you should apply in SRC dot 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 in something, then controller part will be there. It is dependent upon which PSR we are using. Okay, so we are using PSR4. Earlier, when Drupal started 2012, we were using PSR0. In Drupal 8, PSR4 is being used. And it helps us to auto-load that class. Like for hello underscore world, we want to write a controller. So right now what we do is in the folder, main controller folder of hello underscore world, we have SRC folder, in that we have the controller folder, then we have the controller.php file. Yes, SRC folder is enough for all controllers. We can have SRC. From that there is a subfolder name controller. And it will have a subfolder name form. So different kind of controllers are there in SRC. Okay, that's the exact details you can, I don't know, but what I could get from reading the bit is that the folder structure get more wide, the you have to write SRC dot dot controller. Yes? Yes, sir, I'm showing. Just explaining the namespace. And namespace is basically, suppose I have a notification functionality coming from one third library. Or some specific function, maybe custom underscore hello underscore world, coming from my module also and some other module also. Then you will have a problem. Because two functions can never have the same name. So what helps us is namespace. It helps us that all classes can also almost have the same name. Like, you know, notifier coming from Zen and coming from some Google library or something like that. They can have same name, but they have a different namespace, like Zen, like Google or like Drupal. Their namespaces are different, so they can have same name of classes. That's where namespaces come in. Okay, so how do we do it? It's just with this namespace we are using here for our hello for module, Drupal slash hello slash control. That's it. We all need to know about the namespace and it will handle all things. Here we are using a use command. This will auto load my class from whatever file we have into our module. Okay, it will look little complicated, Drupal slash, code slash, controller slash, something, but eventually, in maybe we work for 2-3 weeks and we will come to know exactly, it will become more intuitive because it's a standard pattern. Okay, so you would not have to look into again Drupal and find out, it will become more intuitive. So it won't be like you have to learn Drupal to write this Drupal. Okay, it will be more open kind of thing. So you know general programming, you can write now. Program. So this is basically complete our hello world. If we write one info.yml file, that will complete our, we need three files. One is info.yml, one is allowed, and one we require a controller. We need not know about so many things in Drupal, we could just write these three files and our hello world module is ready. One is info file, which I've not shown, you can easily write just like Drupal server. Then there is a allowed file and a controller file. That completes our hello world module. Okay, there are other custom components like serializer, which basically help us specifically when we are writing our APIs or anything we are doing, we want the object is there and it converts it to array and then finally whichever format you want, which JSON, if you want XML or whatever format, this component basically help us to convert these things and this is pretty easy to just look it afterwards. These things are very easy. Similarly, there is a validator which will help us to the content of any test. You want some numeric value from specific test, or like you want 200 specifically. So this basically this class help us to find out from test or from user input whether the data we are expecting is good enough or not. So this is a standard. That name is standard. You want to check ID, range, number, collection, anything, local, country, so it has a more standard way of looking into all validation. Okay. So these are the references and resources which you can look at. Thank you, and if you have any questions, you can ask. Yes? Specifically the Symphony book which is there on the Symphony website, specifically the first chapter which has the HTTP foundation. It gives you more, otherwise you don't understand how things are happening. So it gives you a good idea about how request and response are being handled. Just to have a look. You don't want to write those things, but just to understand how browser works. It gives you a very good idea, and the talk by founder of Symphony is also there on YouTube, which was given in DrupalCon, and it's also very good to understand whatever I have spoken. It's part of some that presentation. Okay, so it's a very good presentation. He has explained in more details, and you can catch it and you can have it. You can upload this presentation on the GoogleCamp website and SlideShare.
I don't know what is it. I find PHP, now I don't know anything. I don't know what is it.